Welcome to the World Leaders Forum at Columbia University. We are very grateful to the heads of state who are visiting New York this week for the UN General Assembly for coming up to Morningside Heights to share their thoughts and to engage with our faculty and students. These forums help define what is unique and valuable about being here at this university in this great global city. We are very honored to be joined this morning by His Excellency, President Mohamed Moncef Marzouki of the Republic of Tunisia. Mr. President, we very much look forward to hearing your address, the Arab Spring, and the Tunisia Initiative on Creating a Constitutional Court. As most of you are aware, Tunisia has been at the center of much of the unrest that has swept across North Africa and the Middle East since the late 2010. The intervening years have brought historic upheaval, the toppling of strongman governments and the outbreak of sectarian violence that has spilled across borders and helped fuel the spread of savage extremism across the entire region. In Tunisia, the challenge has been to forge a new democratic government out of the ashes of autocracy. The transition has been long and complex, but in January of 2014, legislators were rewarded for their efforts with the ratification of a new constitution that has been widely praised for its protections of democratic freedoms, its guarantee of political parity for women, and its creation of an independent judiciary. Indeed, what sets Tunisia apart from so many other countries struggling to achieve lasting democracy has been the willingness of rival political factions to set aside deep-seated mistrust and to spend months, even years, negotiating with one another and to make meaningful sacrifices for consensus and compromise. When elections are held this fall, the world will be looking at Tunisia to provide a model of transparency and fairness. President Marzouki would, of course, be the first to tell you that despite the promise offered by the new constitution, his country faces significant challenges that continue to threaten its stability. A stagnating economy and a weak private sector and high unemployment have left many citizens deeply concerned about the future. And the spread of violent extremism has cast a long shadow over the nation's cities and towns. Security remains a predominant concern, with militants waging guerrilla warfare on government officials and local law enforcement. There are also reports that Tunisians have been joining extremists in the fight against Syrian President Assad, adding the country to the long list of nations with citizens who have become radicalized by terrorist organizations. President Marzouki comes here today as a member of an interim government set up to run the country during this difficult period of transition. An accomplished physician, he has spent much of his life in exile for his and his family's opposition to the authoritarian regimes that governed Tunisia for more than 50 years. Before his return and subsequent election in 2011, he was imprisoned for a time as a dissident and served as the founder and leader of several human rights organizations. I'm going to turn the podium over to our guest in a few moments, but before I do, I would like to say a few words about Columbia and our important ties with Tunisia as a subject of important academic examination. There is, of course, a wide array of courses that explore Tunisian politics and culture in subjects ranging from history and literature to journalism and urban studies. We have faculty and students performing research and engaging in on-the-ground work, a group of business school students who met with executives in Tunis, and scientists studying the historic drought in North Africa. We have invited President Marzouki here today because we understand that the stakes are very high during this signal moment in his country's history. And we value our position here at Columbia as a place where men and women involved in meeting the major challenges of this century come to discuss and debate them. Please join me in welcoming President Marzouki to Columbia University. Welcome.
Ladies and gentlemen, and I would like to say that I'm really very honored to be here in this prestigious university. And of course, I am very moved to talk about what's happening in my country and in the other Arab world, because what's happening in this part of the world is extremely important, not only for us, but I think also for the whole world. Let me begin by this article published by The Economist last July, whose title is The Tragedy of Arabs, The Tragedy. I'm going to quote this article because I think this opinion is widely shared by a lot of Westerners, and we have to take it in account. This is what's written. Why Arab countries have so miserably failed to create democracy, happiness, or, aside from the windfall of oil, wealth for their 350 million people is one of the great questions of our time. What makes Arab society susceptible to vile regimes and fanatics bent on destroying them and their perceived allies in the West? No one suggests that the Arabs as a people lack talent or suffer from pathological antipathy to democracy. But for the Arabs to wake from their nightmare and for the world to feel safe, a great deal needs to change. When you read behind the lines, the key words are tragedy, failure. The world has to feel safe because those people are not safe, or they are a threat against us, Westerners, probably against the whole civilization. What struck me in this article is no word about the responsibility of the British, because this newspaper is a British newspaper. No words about the responsibility of the British, no word about the responsibility of the creation of the State of Israel, its impact on the whole region for more than 50 years. No word about the responsibility of the West in promoting and supporting harsh, corrupted dictatorship. No word about the responsibility of the, I'm not dismissing our responsibility. This is not my objective. Of course, we have our own responsibility, but it's honest to say that there is also the responsibility of other actors. And When you read behind the lines, you feel, you know, look, when he says no one suggests that the Arabs are people lack talent or suffer, no one suggests, but in fact, when you read it, means that you can be sure that Arabs are people. I'm not here also trying to look like a, you know, victim of paranoia or so forth, but I have suffered my whole life by this racist point of view that Arabs are people lacking talent or suffering from antipathy to democracy and so forth. This opinion is widely shared in the West by many, many, many people, even if they don't want to acknowledge it. But sometimes you find that some writers or journalists are more honest than this one to accept that there's a part, this is the West has its own responsibility in this tragedy of Arabs. Something more sophisticated you can read, and I read last week in the New York Times by Thomas Friedman. It's September 18th. This is what I quote once again. For years, the United States has played the role of central bank of Middle East stability. Just as the European Central Bank funding delays the day that France has to go through structural reform. The key word here is stability. Because for the West, the only thing that matters is stability. And I can understand that the word stability, even now, is a magic word. It means peace, it means order, it means good business, and so forth. But for me, as a human rights activist, living for more than five decades under this kind of stability, what does this word mean? Well, for me and for my generation, it means mainly that it's social and cultural stagnation imposed by harsh political repression with massive human rights violation, whose objective is to exploit the country's wealth to the benefit of the local and the Western elite. Both interested, both allies, in keeping the statu quo as long as possible. In fact, when you talk about, you know, confrontation between civilization and states, and it's nonsense. I can assure you, because now I am inside the state, that it's nonsense. It's not like this at all. It's just, you know, elites, Arab elites, Western elites, both allies, you know, defending their same interest, and sometimes traitor to their country, you know, and probably both as corrupted, both corrupted. And once again, the objective of this stability is to maintain this status quo as long as possible so they can make their business and they can make impose their opinion how the society should be government. The problem is that this kind of stability never lasts. And then you have the Arab Spring, the so-called Arab Spring, because I would like to, you know, to reconsider this, the word Arab Spring, because it means nothing. When you think to spring, of course, you think about cherry blossoms, birds singing, peace, serenity. It's not at all what happened in the Arab world. I would compare it to the, I would rather talk about an Arab volcano or an Arab earthquake. Arab volcano would be more suitable because it's really much more what happens in the Arab world from December 17th, 2010, date of the outbreak of the Tunisian revolution and the extension to Libya, Egypt, Syria, and Yemen is very far away from this idyllic or romantic image of spring. We should talk of Arab volcano as in a volcano. It's violent. We have violent explosion with rumbles, toxic fumes, dead, injured people, chaos, and so forth. This is exactly what happened in our region, and this is what is going on. The volcano, the Arab volcano, is still erupting. And I think for a while, maybe for two or three decades, this must be understood. Well, if we try to, I'm going to talk about from my position as political actor and also as an intellectual. What does it mean, all this eruption? I think it's, first of all, it's the most important crisis of our modern history, probably the most important after the independence. And it's a huge crisis. You have now in this world 300 or about 400 million people now living in the deepest crisis in their history. And you know, 400 million people living in the central part of the world, living this huge, extremely dangerous crisis that will have a lot of side effects on your situation, on your own history. And this crisis is probably the deepest. Why? Because it's a comprehensive crisis. It's the crisis of the state. It's the crisis of the society. It's the crisis of Islam. It's the crisis of, you know, everything. It's the crisis of the, first, let's begin with the crisis of the state. The state in the Arab country has been always hated, despised, feared, mainly feared, you know. Currently now, after this eruption, the state is no longer feared, no longer accepted, and mainly the state has now, the crisis of the state is to find a new relationship to citizens. And this is the first time in our history that the state is so weak. The state has been weakened by the revolution, and nobody now in Tunisia or elsewhere, even in Egypt, even in Iraq, even everywhere, the state is no longer feared. So I'm not saying that this state is giving up all method, repression and so forth, but I think that even if it reverts to the old technique, that won't work, that won't do, and I think the time of that Arabs were fearing their state is completely over. It's also the crisis of the society, because, you know, our society now are facing their old demons, their old divisions, previously hidden by national states. The crisis has revealed that the national state has simply repressed, but not erased, the old divisions between Muslim and Muslim, Muslim and Christian, Shia and Sunni, Sunni and Sunni, and so forth. So now the society is facing all this division, and they have to tackle them properly. This division were hidden, but now they have the society has to resolve the problem. Sometimes this old problem are, you know, for centuries, for instance, the problem Shia and Sunni, it's 10th century old problem. And it's also the crisis of Islam, because Islam is splitting now in a lot of Islams, you know. People still think about the Islamist as a whole, but in fact, its wide range spectrum is extremely wide, and it's now widening. You have moderate, you have extremist, and then you have the extremist of the extremist, you know, for the ISIS, the extremist of Al-Qaeda. And all those Islamist groups are hating themselves sometimes more than they hate us secularists. And they are fighting against themselves more than they are fighting against us. So it's a deep crisis within the Islamist movement itself, you know, whether they will, because they have to make terrible choices, you know, whether they will accept to live with secularists like in Tunisia, whether they will try to set up what they call a caliphate and so forth. It's the deepest crisis in the Islamist trend itself. So when you have this profound crisis, the state, the society, Islam itself, you can imagine that we are living now, it's a sort of chaos in the structure, political structure, chaos in the minds and so forth. And this crisis is probably going to last for many decades. Once again, I'm telling you that don't expect, you know, the whole problem to be solved in 2 or 3 months or on 2 or 3 years. This is why intervening in the Middle East crisis, you know, for Americans must be very, you know, have to think twice about it, because it won't be a matter of months or years. It could be a matter of decades. So, but what I must say also, that this huge crisis, the deep crisis and so forth, is probably the most important opportunity for the Arab world, you know, to have a real new departure. And when you look to the situation of two countries like Syria and like Tunisia, you see how different is the outcome from one country to another. Because, you know, when people think about the Arab world, they think that the Arab world is also a wide spectrum, and the situation are extremely different, the countries are extremely different. This is why the outcome of this eruption is extremely different. When you see what's happening in Syria, you have the chaos. You have this chaos, and I'm afraid I like very much this country. I have been many times in Syria. It's one of the most civilized Arab country, and I'm extremely unhappy, extremely sad, you know, to see what's happening in this country. Very old country, sophisticated country, civilized country, and so forth. but with this chaos, terrible chaos, and I wonder what would be the outcome, even when this war is over. So the outcome, the volcano in this part of the world is destroying the country, destroying the state, destroying the society, and so forth. And it would take time, decades and decades, to reconstruct all this. But in Tunisia, the situation is extremely different. This volcano, this eruption, has given us in Tunisia the opportunity to reconstruct our society on solid ground. And I'm very proud to say that we did well. You probably know that during the last 3 years, we didn't have a civil war like in other countries. You probably know that we have a written constitution, and we are very proud of this constitution. It's the best, one of the best constitution I can say in the world, defending, promoting human rights, gender equality, freedom of expression, and so forth, freedom of conscience, etc., etc. And it was not easy, you know, to reach consensus about this constitution when you have a divided society, with an important part of it which is secularist and the other part is Islamist. And I'm very proud because, not only because of the text, but because the way we wrote it, we have had discussion. You know, thousands and thousands of Tunisians have discussed this, the text, and have adopted it. So we can say that in Tunisia, contrary to what happened in countries like Yemen or Syria and so forth, this Arab Spring has been our opportunity to reconstruct real democracy. Now we are going to have elections in 2 months' time. This election would probably will be also one of the best in our history. And I think after this election, we are going to have stable and democratic states. So the tragedy of Arabs, of the British journalist about talking about Arabs unable to have democratic states, this is completely ridiculous, because Tunisia will be a democratic state, will be a stable state, and so forth. And in Tunisia, human rights would be protected, gender equality would be protected, and so forth. So, and we will be very, very proud of this our success story. But so you see that the outcome would be is extremely different, and the outcome would be very different also from country to country. It would take time, but what I hope, at the least, you know, volcanoes. Yes, volcanoes. The image of the volcanoes, we have dead and we have injured people, but also the volcanoes give us more land and sometimes the best soil. This is why all over the world peasants, you know, are sticking to volcanoes, because they do know that this could be also a new opportunity for them. And this is what's happening for us. Part of the volcanoes is destroying part of our societies, but the aftermath of this volcano would be probably more land and richer soil, crops. This is what I wish for myself and wish for my country, and what I wish for you, because that's your problem. I would like to revert to go back to Friedman. He wrote in the same article, "An existential struggle is taking place in the Arab world, but is it ours or is it theirs? Before we step up military action in Iraq and Syria, that is the question that needs answering." Well, the answer is very, very easy. It's our problems, but it's also yours problem. It's our problems, all of us, Arabs and Westerners. Because if we do not succeed, what would happen is that you will have this chaos in this part of the world, and this chaos will have side effects, important side effects on your society. I think some lessons should be drawn from what's happening now. First, the true stability is the one given by sharing power, reign of law, democratic regime, economic development well distributed in the population. It's obvious, but it has to be said. Second, the more you wait to do political reform and social reform, the more frustration accumulate, and then the more violent and destructive will be the explosion and difficult the reconstruction. This is what should be taken in account by some Arab leaders. We still think that, look, I'm going to avoid what happened in Tunisia. No, they won't happen. They won't avoid it, because all the Arab people now want freedom, want more social justice, and so forth. So the more you wait, the more the explosion would be violent. And then the local elite and their Western allies, if they do not want more revolution, should stop, you know, this false reform and have the courage and the intelligence to do the real ones, because this was cost them much less than the inevitable revolution. And then when the explosion takes place, the process must go to its term. Meanwhile, we must try to manage the chaos at best possible. Other lessons, when the local elite, hunted by the revolution, want to revert to the statu quo ante, like in some country currently, in fact, it won't solve that problem. It will simply prepare to a new explosion, to a new outbreak. Last but not least, I think the Westerners, if they want to defend their own interests, must refrain from supporting regimes condemned by their people, push their friends to real reforms, and help massively countries such as Tunisia, which could be the first success story in this Arab world, the first country that breaks with the so-called tragedy of the Arabs. Thank you, sir, very much.
Mr. President, Excellencies, I will say a few words on the Tunisian initiative for the establishment of an international constitutional court. The first thing to say about this is that the Arab Spring gave us the opportunity to have new ideas, new thoughts on the future of our region and of the world. The Tunisian initiative for the establishment of an international constitutional court is one of these new ideas that we are proposing to the whole world. Tunisia now is working on this initiative, and we are presenting it to the academia and to the international institutions. In few words, the project is to establish an international court composed of judges from all the parts of the world, which has jurisdiction over two kinds of issues. First, the access to power. Second, the exercise of power. I want to say that the access to power poses the question of how can people become in power. The main idea is that the access to power has to be peaceful and through free and democratic elections. And this court watches or has to watch how people in the different countries in the world have access to power. Second, the exercise of power. The main idea is that in order to be legitimate, a power in place has to respect human rights. So this court has to be a human rights court plus something else, which is elections and every question that has a link to the access to power and peaceful access to power. The main question, certainly, which everyone asks himself when he listens about this court and hears about this court, is whether it is needed or not. Our answer is clear. Yes, the world needs this court. Democratic countries need this court, and non-democratic countries need this court, and also countries who are becoming democratic need also this court. If you see in all the parts of the world, you will see that there is a human rights court in Europe, whereas there is democracy and there is respect of human rights in Europe, but they need this court, and this court has things to do in the future, not only in the past. In Africa, we have a human rights court, and in America also. So the world needs also a court which has a wider jurisdiction, which goes also to other aspects, especially linked to the access to power, the peaceful and the free elections that lead to power. In fact, the Tunisian initiative is a new step after a first initiative which was launched by Australia in 1945, and after that in 2008 by Switzerland, which also came back to the first initiative of Australia for the establishment of a human rights court. But both initiatives did not reach their goals. So our initiative is a further step which adds something to the old initiatives and which goes a little bit further. The court has to be composed of 21 judges elected from different parts of the world by international bodies and international courts. The rules to be applied by this court are mainly the common rules between all the constitutions of the world and also the rules which are recognized by international conventions, charters, and covenants. This court has to rule on claims coming from people from inside the country. So no foreign country has the right to bring a claim against another country. It's only the citizens and the civil society and political organizations from the country itself who may go before this court and bring a claim. The court makes jurisdictional decisions, I mean judgments, not only advisory opinions. Of course, it will have also an advisory role, but it will rule or issue judgments. And when I say judgments, I'm talking about res judicata. The court can also give advisory opinions to countries when they request it. And the judgments will not be enforceable as state court judgments. In fact, the court only gives the judgment, and the execution of the judgment will be another thing. It will not mainly be executed by force. What we have until now is that first we organized many conferences and meetings in Tunisia and outside Tunisia in order to present and explain the idea in Tunisia and outside, in Geneva, for example, last August. Second, Tunisia presented a draft resolution to the African Union in order to take the decision for the or to support the establishment of this court and at the international level. And now the current step is that we are going to request to the UN Secretary General to submit this issue to the International Law Commission of the United Nations in order to be studied by the Commission, and after that to come back to the General Assembly for final vote. And we are also going to start the drafting of an international convention on the establishment of this court. Thank you for your attention.
Let me explain the origin of this idea, because it's very important. When I was in exile in France, when Ben Ali used to have his false election, you know, with 99% of yes, and it was terrible for us, because we didn't have any we couldn't do anything, you know, because in our country, of course, we didn't have a constitutional court, because under the dictatorship you cannot have this kind of body. And we cannot complain to any international body, because everybody would say, look, it's your business, it's not ours. But in fact, if we want to protect Democrats fighting against dictatorship in non-democratic country, and if we want countries like Tunisia at that time, you know, to be accepted, we should have this kind of international body saying, hey, this regime is not valid. This regime is anti-democratic. We don't have to do anything with this kind of, you know, this political structure at the international level doesn't exist. And this is why our participation as Tunisian, as Arabs, to promote democracy in the world is to fight for this new body. And I'm quite sure that we're going to have a lot of difficulty or a lot of problems because many states are not interested in having this court. But I'm going to fight the rest of my life for having this court because I'm deeply convinced that this would shorten the life of non-democratic regime, and this would help promote democracy. Many people think that democracy is okay, it's forever, even in this country or in Western country. I don't believe that. I do believe that democracy is still threatened everywhere, and then if we don't fight for it, where it is, and if we don't fight for, to promote it where it is not, I'm sure that with the numerous crises we are going to face, the comeback of populist parties in Europe, racist parties all over the world, extremists, Islamist extremists, Hindu extremists, Jewish extremists, Christian extremists, and so forth, the democracy is really in threatened, and we have to keep this idea in mind. Otherwise, we would be very, very naive. Thank you.
Mr. President, thank you very much for speaking to us and to doing so in such a heartfelt and a serious and meaningful way. And so I want to begin that. People can line up for questions. We have time for a few questions. Let me begin with a question for you. It seems to me that what you have done is to ask us to really rebalance our perspective on what is happening in the Arab world and to accept responsibility for this and to understand it better and to participate with you in trying to make the very best of this, as you are trying to do. Could you say what it is? If the rest of the world and the West in particular, of Europe and the United States, if we were to embrace a proper perspective on what is happening and to realize the importance of what is happening in Tunisia, what over the next few years would you ask of these countries and regions to do to help ensure the success of Tunisia and the broader Arab world?
First, help Tunisia, because Tunisia, I'm not only speaking because it's my country and I'm proud of it and I have to defend it. But I do think, as an Arab intellectual, that Tunisia should be a success story, and then you have to defend Tunisia, first of all, helping Tunisia to improve its economy, because once again, the revolution, it's not only because lack of freedoms, it's also because poverty. The most important violation of human rights is poverty. We have to combat poverty. So if Tunisia, if Western investors would come to Tunisia, they would invest also in peace and in democracy, not only in economy. This is the first step. The second is, to put the pressure on some countries where they didn't have this volcano, the eruption of this volcano, where they think naively that it won't happen. That if they have good, if the repression is more accurate and so forth, they would prevent. I'm quite sure that this is not true. So the United States has a lot of influence on many Arab countries. They have to push them to make the real reform, that means to share power, that means to, for some countries, for instance, I think that the political prisoners should be released, and freedoms should be restored, and there the United States could play an important role. And unfortunately, we are facing also terrorist threat, then we would need also to face this terrorist threat together. But once again, the terrorist threat, Al-Qaeda and ISIS and so forth, it's not just a military problem. It's not just a problem of, fighting this violence by violence. It's going to the roots of the problem, and the roots of problems, once again, sharing power, social and economic development, freedoms, and stable society. If we do not address the roots of the problem, I can assure you that we are going to nurturing ISIS, and the ISIS would overcome, because ISIS is the reason of the success of ISIS are still there. This should be taken into account.
Thank you very much. So let's keep questions short because we're a little over time, and I think it might be best to take three questions and then the President can answer them together perhaps. Would you please begin?
President Marzouki, my name is Michael, and I want to thank you on behalf of the Undergraduate Committee for Global Thought at the university. What I would like to ask is, with the November presidential elections coming up in Tunisia, whether or not you are planning on running for another term, and if you are, why there has been a certain air of mystery about your intentions in the general field of presidential candidates in this very important election.
Thank you very much. Next.
Hey, thank you again. It's an honor to have you speak here. You talked about the influence of elites in both the West and in Tunisia, and I'm wondering what you hope that Tunisia would plan on enacting in order to limit that influence and what you could learn from the struggles of the United States in curbing elite influence.
Next. And we'll do one more, so we'll have four to go.
Thank you very much for being here, President Marzouki. I'm Rachel Mayer from the Institute for the Study of Human Rights, and my question actually concerns the court and its implementation, its jurisdiction, and how the court can actually have an effect and hold all of the leaders, as said, accountable.
Thank you very much. Next.
Hi, my name is Khaled and I'm from Yemen. Initially, we welcomed the Arab Spring, and as a matter of fact, we mobilized the community here in the USA to rallies and do their part. Unfortunately, the country has fallen into the abyss and is becoming the next Somalia. What's the role of the international community, especially developing countries, in helping stabilize these countries, such as Yemen?
So we have four questions. Are you running?
Yes.
Secondly,
yes.
Elites and
yes,
so on.
I am. Yes, I am. Because I think, I may be mistaken, but I think that, you know, it's this election are probably the last battle between the revolution and the counter-revolution, because we see that the old system is coming back. And Tunisians are very much afraid of the old system coming back. It's extremely amazing to see that the people who have been all their life against democracy now are enjoying the fact that we're a democratic country to run, probably once again to go back to the dictatorship. And this is why I feel that it's my responsibility to stop them. Now, what we can learn from the U.S., I must say that, yes, we have suffered as human rights activists for two decades to see that the Western government were supporting our dictatorship because of this famous research of stability and so forth. But I must say that we have been also extremely helped by human rights organizations from the United States, from Europe, and the most important thing I have discovered at the time that this is, states are allies, but also civil societies are allies. And I was deeply, encouraged. We all the militants, all the human rights activists in the Arab world and Tunisia, we have been supported by human rights activists in the United States and in France, in Switzerland, everywhere. And so now I think we have to go further, to improve this relationship, this work between civil society. This would be probably the most important thing that we have to do. It's strange because I'm talking as, half of my brain as president and half of my brain as former president of Human Rights League. But I'm still, I do believe that if we want to avoid this confrontation, so-called confrontation between civilization or state, etc., we have to improve the relationship between civil society. Yes, Yemen. Yemen. It's very, very sad to see the current situation in Yemen. But as I told you, it's when you have this eruption of volcano, the process has to go. You cannot say when a volcano is going to erupt, and you cannot say when the volcano is going to stop eruption. You have to wait, but the process has to go to its end. And I'm deeply convinced that in Yemen, in Syria, and so forth, I wouldn't say we are going to have a happy end, but we have to go the whole process. We have to to pay the price. Many countries have paid the price, you know, Russia, the United States. Every country has its own period of history where it has to pay a heavy price. We're going to have to pay a heavy price, but if we want to become stable, free society, we have to go through the whole process. Now, for the moment, of course, I am a politician. I am dealing with the situation in Libya. We have the same problems in Yemen. We have to keep the country together, you know, to promote discussion between the political actors, to improve the condition of et cetera, so please don't despair of your country. Be sure that at the end, as I told you, the volcano would give you more land and richer soil. About the court jurisdiction, I would like to, perhaps my legal advisor would be much more coming to ask her.
Concerning the jurisdiction of the International Constitutional Court we are proposing, the main idea for us is that there is a body of international rules of constitutional law which are existing yet in the international conventions, international covenants, and international charters, such as, for example, the African Charter for Elections, Democracy, and Governance. So these rules are existing, and these rules have two main domains. First, elections as a means to access to power. Second, human rights and the respect of human rights. So the claims which have to be brought before the court are claims which are in relationship with these two kinds of issues. And I will remark also that the court has or will have jurisdiction over these issues, whether the problem is about a law which was enacted in the country or about a practice, whereas maybe in a country you may have the best laws in the world, but the bad practices or anti-democratic practices. So if you are claiming about a law or about a practice which is against the democratic principles, the court will, inshallah, have jurisdiction over these issues.
Inshallah.
Thank you.
Any more questions?
Mr. President, we don't want to let you go, and that was a model of four questions in a row and a model of answers to every one of them. Let's see if we can repeat that and do four more, and then I think we'll have to call it.
Good morning, Mr. President. My name is Mihua Saunders, and my question is, charters on human rights are traditionally seen as largely symbolic. In looking at the implementation of this constitutional court, I'm wondering, what are the bodies of enforcement that Tunisia is proposing to ensure that human rights violations at most are not violated?
Thank you. Next.
When I was in Tunisia this summer, I definitely encountered the peaceful nature of the society and the people, especially in comparison to the more militarized neighbors like Libya and Algeria. And so my question is, despite that Tunisia definitely faces serious security problems like the attacks last July on the military, and so in terms of direct assistance from the West and partnership with the United States, does Tunisia desire to work on the security and military side of the West, or more stick to other domains such as education and the economy?
Thank you. Next.
Mr. President, Tunisia revolution inspired many countries such as mine, Chile, where there's been a lot of questioning of the constitution we have that was written under a U.S.-supported dictatorship on the 80s that has given stability to the country to the past 30 years. But then it divides people because it was unlawful. So the question is, do you think that the great changes that Tunisia is facing today could have been possible without a revolution of that 99 non-elite percent of the people? And if so, what would be the role of that people in a country, if not a revolution? Thank you.
Thank you. And the last question.
Bonjour, Monsieur le Président. Thank you for speaking to us this morning. I'd like to know what your relationship with the Saudi government is these days in light of the asylum that Ben Ali is currently enjoying in Saudi Arabia, he and his wife. Are you still seeking to extradite him back to Tunisia to face charges for his crimes? Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. President.
Well, I'll begin to answer the last question. I will give you my opinion behind closed door if you want. Now, whether for your question about revolution, yes, Tunisia is. I don't think we could get rid of the dictatorship without a revolution. But you know, the kind of regime we have had in the, we still have in some world, in some part of the Arab world. You know, people, those regimes are sticking to them. You cannot imagine. Even if you are a Chilean, you know the level of violation of human rights. You cannot understand the violence in Syria currently if you do not understand the level of violence by the regime for more than 50 years. It was the most terrible regime of the world, and this regime was accepted by the international community. I'm very, very sad for the Syrian people, because first, this once again, the civilized people, this good people, the good nation, etc., has to accept this kind of regime for more than 50 years, and now the price they're giving to get rid of it is extremely high. It's terribly high. It's unimaginable. In Tunisia, for instance, we were lucky because from the beginning, I used to say we can get rid of our dictatorship by a peaceful revolution. This is exactly what happened. You know, in Tunisia, we have had something like 300 martyrs and 2,000 wounded. When you compare it to the thousands of people dead and millions of refugees in Syria, you see the difference of the cost. So once again, when you have, because of the violence of the regimes, because of the level of their corruption, the Arab people, they don't have the choice. They have to get rid of this dictatorship, whether by a peaceful revolution or by violent revolution. But there we go, though. I don't think that the corrupted elite, because when you talk about dictatorship, you talk about corrupted elite, you know, using the state for their own purpose. This is the real situation. So if those now the elites in some other countries where the eruption didn't happen, if they are not clever, you know, enough to understand that they have to change their mind, they have to change their politics and so forth, I'm afraid that the price would be different, but the outcome would be the same, I think. But the problem is, after the revolution, whether it will be a chaos or democracy, this would be different from one country to another. And about what are you expecting from the United States? Yes, we're having a lot of challenges at the same time, security challenges, economic challenges, political challenges, and so forth. But I think Tunisia, terrorists is not a threat, because Tunisia is a homogeneous society, it's a stable country. Because we are also a real democracy, I don't feel that we are threatened by terrorists. But the main threat is unemployment, poverty, and so forth. Because if we don't tackle these problems, we are going to have a new revolution, a revolution within the revolution, and then this new revolution could lead to chaos. Once again, we are expecting from the United States, from the West, massive investment in Tunisia, because it will not be only investment in factories and so forth. It will be really investment in peace. And about the implementation you probably remember that for many decades we have asked that the criminals, you know, are tried, and at last we have had this international criminal court, international criminal court. So you see that it's not only a matter of symbolic attitude or so forth. You can have some results, and I think if we can build up this constitutional court, we can have the same kind of result. But it would be difficult, and it would take time.
Mr. President, thank you so much on behalf of Columbia University and all the people who are here and people who can hear you online. We are all rooting for you in support of. Thank you so much for coming to Colombia.